Let's kick off. And let me welcome members and our visitors to the 18th meeting in 2015 Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. I remind everyone, as usual, to switch off mobile phones as they may affect the broadcasting system. We have received apologies today from Dave Thompson, who can't be with us. Let me move to agenda item one, which is for Fiona McLeod to declare any relevant interests. Let me welcome Fiona back to the committee, which she previously served on. George joins us to replace George Adam, and I'd like to place on record our thanks to George for his work on the committee. Let me invite Fiona to declare any relevant interests.
Thank you, convener. I have no relevant interest to declare.
Thank you very much, Fiona. Let's move on to item two, which is for the committee to agree to take items five and six in private. Item five is for members to consider the evidence heard at the round table on the Scotland Lobbying Bill, which we're about to commence. And item six is for members to consider correspondence received from the private presiding officer. Do members agree to take these items in private?
Agreed.
Thank you. We're agreed. Agenda item three is for members to agree to take the following in private at future meetings. Firstly, consideration of evidence heard, issues papers and a draft stage one report on the Lobbying Scotland Bill. Secondly, code of conduct changes in relation to cross-party groups. And thirdly, code of conduct changes and changes to the written statement forms in relation to the interests of members of the Scottish Parliament Amendment Bill. Do members agree to take these items in private at future meetings? We are agreed to take these items in private at future. We now come to the main substance of today's meeting, agenda item four, which is for the committee to take evidence in stage one of the lobbying bill. We are operating this in a round table format, and just to indicate how I'd like us to try and play it and get the best out of it. The convener will try and take as light a touch as possible, perfectly content that people interact with each other over the table, but let's try and remember that it's kind of what's best if only one person's speaking at a time, and I will intervene to make sure that that actually happens. I expect we'll hear a number of statements and assertions and claims from people. That's perfectly proper. What I hope that people, when they do that, do, however, is they explain to us why they make these statements and claims. And if any of us feel that that isn't happening, we may invite the member who's making a claim. And I just give as an example, not to single anyone out for any particular reason, but simply because I have a paper that the Electoral Reform Society on the lobbying bill have provided us with. And one of the things that is said there is that the old way of representative democracy is described as being in malaise. Well, that's fair enough. We might instinctively feel we could agree to some extent with that. But if we were to say something of that character at this meeting, I would expect to hear some expression of where that's actually come from. Now, it's perfectly legitimate for that to come from the experience of the individual who says it and for them to say that that's why they say it. And that's okay. But, of course, where something's come from will help us weigh in the balance what might be conflicting things. So, slightly longer preamble. Let me just recognise that today we have Professor Raj Chari from the Department of Political Science at Trinity College. We have Dr. William Dinnan from Spinwatch. Yes, you're over there. John Downey from SCVO. Peter Duncan, I think I can fairly say representing lobbyists, or at least a lobbyist in his own right, if not representing them. Neil Finlay, who, of course, perhaps set the Parliament on this course some considerable time ago. Welcome here as well. Steve Goodrich from Transparency International. There we are. I've got a wee chart, but I haven't got myself familiar with it. Steve Mon, the head of campaigns at CBI. I beg your pardon. You're quite correct. Yes. Well done.
That's me, by the way.
You know, it's quite encouraging to know to be reassured that you know who you are. Andy Miles, a well-kent face in these corridors from Environment Link, and Willie Sullivan from the Electoral Reform Society. Now, we have a number of themes that we are going to try and structure our inquiry and round table round today. But it's not an exclusive lesson. If there's another theme emerges, then, of course, let's go there. The headings we've got, just to share with you, is striking the balance. You know, does this strike the right balance between not making it so burdensome as to, in particular, discourage small organisations from engaging in Parliament and seeking to persuade us to a particular point of view, but at the same time capturing enough information that it genuinely helps the general public and the third sector see what's actually going on. Direction, definitions and exclusions, have we captured in what's before us what lobbying actually is and how it works? Threshold and triggers, because do we capture things, do we things leave out? What's in the register? How the compliance regime works? And ultimately, the last one, which I suspect may not exercise us in this forum too much, does the bill give Parliament enough flexibility to change, for example, the contents of the register and the way things work, as we learn from experience of the register that we need to further refine it? Do we have sufficient powers? But I suspect that may be for the parliamentarians to consider rather than this particular group. Right, having said all that, I'm minded to let this run for approximately an hour, but you know, we'll not cut it off in mid-sentence. Who wants to start? See, we've not prearranged anything. This is... Right, Andy.
That's a well-kent face. We're out of several well-kent faces because I've been here in different roles. And as a former special advisor to government ministers, can actually say that I've been a lobbyist and lobbied in this building. And so I'm able to see it from both points of view. I don't know whether that makes me a gamekeeper or a poacher, but probably a bit of both. The first thing that I'd say on behalf of Environment Link is that we still think there are blind spots in this bill. If I'm doing an advocacy training course for our members, one of the first lessons is sort out what your message is, what you're actually trying to lobby for, and secondly, sort out who your target is. Who's going to be making the decision? Who do you need to talk to? And that will often not be an MSP. It will often be a civil servant or a special advisor. And they're covered by the Code of Conduct of the Civil Service, which is not mentioned in the policy memorandum or anything. It's as though when they use the word government, the government is only government ministers. But of course, I mean, I would beg of you to remember that vast numbers of the decisions that are not made by ministers. It would be humanly impossible for ministers to make all the decisions that government makes. So I think there are blind spots in there, and I'm peculiarly aware of them with regard to special advisors, for example. On the other side of this, there's this question of the striking of balance between onerous information and all of these questions. And the first thing I'd like to say on behalf of the environmental organisations that are members of Link is that we are completely committed to transparency and openness. We publish our briefings to MSPs, we publish our letters to ministers on our website, and we completely understand the need for openness. But I'm representing civic organisations, I'm not representing commercial interests. None of my members are lobbying for commercial interests. They're not going to gain from this. They're regulated already as charities, and they are in a particular position. So is this going to be onerous under this bill for my members? This is not talking about commercial lobbyists. This is talking about civic organisations in Scotland. Well, the answer is, I fear that it might be. I could be reassured by the committee, and I hope to hear some reassurance. I hope to be hear reassurance from the government. But my fear is that the bill is taking an approach to these charitable and civic organisations which is not proportionate. And the reason I say that is simple. If you take a member like the RSPB Scotland, they've got paid staff. And I was their head of advocacy and media for 8 years, and I told them all, every one of you is a lobbyist. Every one of you has a duty to talk to MSPs. Every one of you has a duty to talk to journalists. You know, there's no member of staff who's supposed to be protecting birds who should think that you can do that without talking to MSPs. So are all those paid staff to be registered for that organisation? But of course, they're not the only ones, because the RSPB also has volunteers who might be coming along to represent the organisation when talking to MSPs. Furthermore, they might have people who are RSPB representatives on an Environment Link task force coming along to lobby on behalf of Link, my own organisation, but they're not paid by Link. They're paid by their own members. So are they paid lobbyists or unpaid lobbyists? Do they have to have an active or an inactive registration? And that question is one that's been weighing on my mind as I read the policy memorandum in particular. There are other issues which will come out perhaps during the course, but to start off with, I just want to say that there are still blind spots in the bill, and there are some real questions for civic organisation. And my fear is that the complication and the complexity of the registration process may have the same effect as the Westminster Bill, which undoubtedly has had effect on civic society in terms of making people shy away from the valuable participation which is recognised by this committee and this Parliament, and is a really, really, really valuable and important part of Scottish political life.
Patricia?
Yeah, I just wanted to come back to Mr. Miles and ask, just for the sake of our discussion, you mentioned that there were what you called blind spots, and you mentioned special advisers as possibly one category of blind spot, but did you have any other people in or categories of people in mind? I know that I think the Electoral Reform Society's briefing paper, which I haven't had a chance to properly read because we got it this morning, suggests senior civil servants, for example. Was that the kind of thing you were thinking?
We mentioned specifically senior civil servants in our earlier written submissions. Yep. on the process of lobbying. We also have mentioned special advisers. And I would add to that, if we didn't mention them, senior officials inside government agencies. Because frequently I might advise a member, no, don't bother going and bothering a member of the Rural Affairs Committee with that. What you want to do to is speak to that official in Scottish Natural Heritage or SEPA. That's who you want to talk to. So they're included as well inside government agencies.
Okay, thanks.
Peter?
I just briefly would like to perhaps just accept much of what Andy has said. First of all, I should say that you interest me as representing the lobbyists. I would probably just push back slightly and say around this table we're probably all lobbyists. And I think it's an important, whilst I remember recall making the point to you to last year, that actually we are all part of the same game here, which is looking to put forward a point of view. MSPs will look to put forward a point of view within their own group meetings to each other. Voluntary groups, charities, with respect to Andy, will be looking to put forward a point of view, which is equally valid as anyone who wants to pay someone to put forward a point of view. In answer to your initial category that you set out, does it strike a balance? I think certainly APPC takes the view that this does strike a balance. I mean, as you know, we started from a position of not seeing the overwhelming public case, we have to say, for legislation in this area. There is not an overwhelming public problem. But we accept a case has been made, And if there is going to be legislation, this is a decent and balanced starting point. Like Andy, I think there are some areas which are illogical exclusions. For example, I don't think it makes sense that just because a meeting has been initiated by an MSP, that suddenly that makes it different from a meeting that's been initiated by someone else, for example. I concur with the view that senior civil servants, that special advisers would logically come. What we're interested in, if there is going to be legislation, it needs to be sustainable and it needs to be sensible. And if it's not sustainable or sensible, then there then will be overwhelming public demand created. We didn't think there was a problem to address, but given that we are going to address it, let's get it right. And let's create a problem that wasn't there in the first place.
I've seen a number of people catch my eye, and I'll just tell you the order I've got them in at the moment. Willie, Neil, Steve, and then John is my current list. So it's Willie first.
Okay, thanks. Willie Sullivan, Electoral Reform Society. Yeah, I think one of the questions that I want to address, first of all, is this idea of proportionality. And somebody described it as a sledgehammer to crack a nut. So I just think we should have a look at the size and strength of the nut. In your introduction, you spoke about this concept of democratic malaise, which is not ERS's concept. It's a concept well known in political science and being discussed as a big problem at the moment. And our contention is that, I've given you election turnout figures. I did some focus groups with Ipsos Murray last year. All sorts of study from the Economist Democracy Index to others say that there's a real problem with people's view of representative democracy and trust in it. And then on the other side, you have the rise of populism, which is a reaction to that. And what people say in these surveys is that the influence of, big, wealthy, powerful interests, sometimes they feel it can often trump the power of the voter. That concept is called democratic and political inequality. And people's view of political inequality, whether it be true or not, that is their perception of it. And that's a real worry. David Runciman, the professor at Cambridge, political scientist, wrote a book last year called The Confidence Trap. And his premise was that democracy is really flexible and takes a lot of hits, but at some point it might not take all those hits and be flexible, and that's the kind of trap that you can fall into. So you can't just rely on it sorting itself all the time. We have to do something about it. And I think transparency is vital to that. People have got to be able to see who's talking to who and in whose interests. So that's the nut I think we're trying to crack. So I think it's, the sledgehammer has to be pretty big. I don't think this bill is given us enough transparency. And the key point I would make is on what triggers registration, and is it just a face-to-face meeting, or is it email exchanges and other forms of digital communication, which we know is quite important in this day and age. And we would suggest that it's quite possible to put that in. It might not be that you have to record over that time period every single email or every other form of electronic communication, but just the person. If we can define clearly the persons that are to be lobbied, so whether it's politicians and senior civil servants and SPADs, which we suggest it is, then any contact with them in any way over that period might go in the register, even if it's 10 emails or one email, as long as that's recorded. And we think that face-to-face meetings should be recorded, the number of them. So if you've got five or face-to-face meetings, then they should be recorded in the day, or one should be recorded. But as far as electronic communications, if it's going to be too onerous to record every single email, then just the fact that the contact was made with that person, we think would be enough.
I think it's fair to say that in looking at how we might extend this, we would probably be more concerned if the number of registrations had to rise, because that could get out of hand in terms of being able to run the register. But if the amount of information that needs to be put in the register for an individual registrant rises, as it would do if we included a wider range of communication, I don't think the committee has yet persuaded itself that would be an issue.
Okay.
You know, so I just say that to sort of give a little context of our current thinking.
Yeah.
We'll come back to you. People are not just getting one shot to speak, you know. So I've now got Neil, Steve, John, and then Richard.
Thanks very much for the invitation to come along. I think for the outset, you know, it's very clear, and I've been clear from when I introduced the bill, that lobbying is a very important part of the democratic process, and nobody. I don't think we'd suggest otherwise, because it informs Parliament, it informs our debates, and I find it very helpful in the work that I do. And there is no evidence of wrongdoing, but that's not to suggest that there may not be wrongdoing, but there is no evidence of that. But the whole thrust of government over the last while is in relation to preventative spend, preventative action, and I see this as a preventative action. We have hopefully ensured that there is no scandal within our Parliament, and I want it to remain that way. And as more powers come to this Parliament, then more lobbying will come. That's just an inevitability. If you look back to before the Parliament was here, there was almost no lobbying going on in Scotland. As powers have increased, the graph goes up significantly and will continue to go up. So this is a preventative measure that we should be putting in to prevent any of any scandal emerging or any wrongdoing. And I think that is the whole purpose. That was the whole purpose behind the bill. I actually think the bill is a bit of a travesty from what I put forward. I think a lot of it bears little resemblance to what was agreed to be taken on by the government. And I think if you look at some glaring examples, the bill appears to be living in the 18th or 19th century and hasn't realised that the telephone and the computer has been invented, that we do things like conference calls and the like, and there's a whole new range of modern communications other than people turning up in top hat and tails to speak to one another face-to-face over tea and crumpets. So I think we have significantly moved on since that was the way in which people lobbied politicians, and I think the bill has to recognise that, because at the moment I think it very much doesn't. I fear we may be in the process of releasing another shoal of red herrings on this stuff with, you know, how onerous this is going to be. Oh, it's hellishly onerous. Well, you know, I'm sure people find it a grind to fill in their expenses form every month, but I'm sure we manage it. And this is not much more than that, because we've seen how other countries operate a register and actually what information you need to put on it. Most of it will already be populated. No, you don't need to put your address and your company number in every month. It's already there on the form. All you're filling in is the detail. And I think in relation to the voluntary sector that Andy mentioned, and, you know, this is going to stop people, and this is, you know, it's going to be hellishly onerous for them. And actually, everyone in the voluntary sector and the charitable sector is there to do good. They're all there to do good. In their opinion, they're there to do good. In other people's opinion, they are not there to do good. And I'll give an example of the debate over same-sex marriage. On one side of the argument, you had charitable organisations saying, we are here doing good, we are promoting same-sex marriage. On the other side of the debate, we had the other side saying, we are here to do good and we're opposing same-sex marriage. So it's not so simple enough just to say that the voluntary sector is a force for good, because it's a force for good in the eyes of the person who's looking at it. So therefore, I think it is essential that voluntary organisations, trade unions and others are covered by the bill.
It may be worth saying, I think in the informal discussions the committee has had with itself, the bill is unlikely to survive in its present form in relation to just oral communications. Okay. I just don't think the committee feels that's... We haven't come to a formal position, so I don't carry the weight of our making a decision, but... hopefully we're, and I think the government's already on a warning on that one and is aware of that. So we'll see where that takes us. Right, I've got Steve, John, Richard, William.
Thank you. Just a quick bit of context about my background. So Transparency International is a global charity with over 100 chapters and 20 years' experience fighting corruption. I'm also a gamekeeper turned poacher. I used to work at the Electoral Commission as a senior policy advisor, so have quite a significant experience dealing with similar types of regulations and engaging with Scottish charities and other organisations throughout the UK on things like regulatory burden, scope of legislation and so forth. So hopefully I've got some expertise to bring to bear here. The first thing I'd like to say is just the Transparency International thinks that fundamentally lobbying and transparency are key pillars of the democratic process, as has been already said, that you need people to engage with, would be MSPs, ministers, but also civil servants to bring to bear expertise from civil society and business as well to make sure that the laws that are passed are fit for purpose and workable in practice. But similarly, it's essential that there's transparency about not only that kind of activity, but about the way in which policy, our polities work, which is why members have to declare their pecuniary interest, which is why that ministers make public their diaries, which is why there's a whole load of things, including the minutes of this meeting, are made public. This is not a new thing that we're asking for. It's just something that complements these arrangements that are already in place. And why are we doing this? And we've talked about what is the issue that we're trying to solve here. And I think there's at least three bits to it, which is not necessarily just to do with scandal. The first is just making politics accountable. And this is not just accountability about those who are making decisions, but accountability for those who are engaged in lobbying practices as well. It's a two-way street. It takes two to tango. So it's about citizens being able to hold representatives, public officials, and also lobbyists to account. Secondly, it's to not only prevent or identify incidents of corruption, but reduce the likelihood of it. Sunlight is the best disinfectant for this kind of thing. If you have more transparency about how our politics works, then there's less opportunity for corrupt incidents to happen. We did a piece of research last year which identified that not only proactively disclosing information helps detect and deter corruption, but also it can help widen understanding about how the democratic process works. And also it's about ensuring that there's equal access to participation, to know, for example, if a business is lobbying a certain individual, it may be that charities or other organisations have a different point of view and they haven't realised that they haven't had their opportunity to put their voices forward. So I think having a more comprehensive register can actually benefit those three public goods, not just to tackle corruption. And just quickly on the definition, I think it's really positive that it's included MSPs within the scope, interactions with them. The UK Register, as you know, doesn't include interactions with MPs. It's also good to see that the Scottish Parliament is recognised and the Scottish Government that there's a need to include in-house lobbyists. We did some research recently that showed that the UK Register only covers a fraction of those who are engaged in engaging public bodies and institutions. But I'd like to echo what's already been said about the need to cover civil servants, need to cover SPADs, and also to cover a wider range of communications, such as telephones and emails. And just thinking, lastly, on the issue of regulatory burdens, I think what we need to ask ourselves is, as a lobbyist myself, we are becoming increasingly adept at actually recording our interactions with public officials. To be an intelligent lobbyist, you actually need to know who you've spoken to. You need to know what you've said to them. That's why they've got things like contact management systems. So I think this is something that certainly, even like we're a relatively small charity, but we're able to do that. And just thinking realistically, in reality, what are the kind of issues? And that's what I'll be interested to hear from other people today. And then how can you mitigate against putting undue regulatory burdens on people? And there's things you can introduce like thresholds. So, for example, if you're only spending over a certain amount of money on lobbying, then you'd have to register. Those are the kind of things that have been applied elsewhere, like with campaigning at elections. And I think whilst they've had some of the some problems with that, that certainly worked to help reduce undue regulatory burdens on campaigners.
Right.
Can I just ask a very brief question on what you said around thresholds? Yeah. And maybe it's just the way my mind works, but could the potential of introducing a threshold not have the effect of creating a loophole that people could be clever about what they do and how they do it so they keep under the radar?
There's the potential for that, I think. It depends on how it's drafted. I mean, going back to my experience of working on thresholds for campaigning at elections, there were certain anti-evasion provisions in there. That stop people from working together effectively as a whole unit to try and evade the thresholds. And that worked relatively well. They applied at the Scottish Independence referendum recently, and My former colleagues there did quite a good job, I think, of engaging with people and getting them to understand how those anti-evasion provisions work. So you need to be mindful that people are always going to try and evade regulatory burdens. So the devil's in the detail, but as a principle, I think it's something that's good to look into.
Right. Now, the people I've got on my list will, when I've exhausted, mean that all our visitors will have spoken. And so it's been quite structured. We can make it less structured, I think, once we've heard from initial people, if I may. So I've got John, Richard, William, Raj, and Andy's the first one to bid to come back. And I'll take him at the end, unless he really wants to come back in the middle. You know, you should, if you want to immediately come back on something that's been said. Oh, well, I'll leave you to the end.
I've got a couple of points that I wanted
to
clarify.
Right, OK, well, I'll come back to you. I'll just take them in the order it's come to. Right, John.
Thank you, convener. I mean, I think it's listening to the different perspectives. I think it's interesting. I think we're looking at this, particularly at the moment. You know, if you look at the bigger context, you know, SCBO were actually in a UK context concerned about the real war on charities at the moment. It's been driven by the UK government. The Lobbying Act is part of that. We saw the attacks on Oxfam and other big charities last year, and frankly, large UK charities are running scared of campaigning at all. At the moment, we had the fundraising review by the UK government in the summer. And actually, if I was being a conspiracy theorist, I would say it was all about £12 billion worth of welfare cuts coming and actually want to mute and actually stop the sector speaking up and campaigning. Now, I say that not because that means we're opposed to the register as it is, but you've got to see it in a context, because we've done some research with our membership that we're about to publish and will no doubt submit to the committee about the impact of the Lobbying Act on them, the UK one. And actually, maybe it's more perception, but actually they are really concerned about it and how that affects them. And I think that, so that there is that there in the whole situation. I think from our point of view, as we've said, our view has always been that the burden of transparency in lobbying should be about those who are being lobbied. And we've talked about MSPs, and we certainly said in our other submission that, you know, ministers, yes, definitely they are SPADs and senior civil servants to a certain level. Now, you might consider that deputy director level, how far you would need to go down and you would look at. But I think for us, again, and it's been mentioned, it is about that proportionality. Yeah, for an organisation like SCVO, we can cope with this. Like Andy says, we're not worried about ourselves. And I had a conversation last night with the director of quite a large Scottish charity who's part of a UK organisation. And I was basically saying to him, what's proposed here, even with email communication included, you could live with it. His response to me was, well, why should we? Now, we've run a balance here between some of our members who want a stronger bill and actually still a lot who are totally opposed to that. We believe the third sector should be included because we are one of the strongest lobbies in Scotland. Let's not forget that. Maybe not quite as good as higher education sometimes, but definitely and others. But we're certainly in there. So I think for us, it's always been about what are the core principles that we're trying to achieve here? What's the solution? What are we trying to do? How do we make it proportionate enough for that we... and I don't think I would agree with Willie in terms of the democratic malaise, but I do think trust is important, and I think that's extremely important for the third sector in terms of the engagement with government. But I think maybe taking on to some of Andy's points, I think it's right. A lot of it is about not just MSPs and committees, but it is about officials. I'll give you a good example. I think it was on the 2nd of July, we did a whole day on new potential employability powers, new social security powers, and we had 35 grassroots members and about 10 medium-sized organisations. And we had probably 15, 16 officials there, and it was a working day to help them understand the complexities of that. Now, the Fair of Scotland document on where we are in welfare powers, published the other week there by the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, included the table from that meeting what actually gave the principles for a social security system for Scotland. So actually, we could probably say that was a lobbying success, but I think the point in relation to the bill would be that I don't want those 35 organisations who are grassroots who are there to be having to register if they don't generally engage with MSPs. we should be able to do that on their behalf, because that was an SCVO convened meeting. It's a bit like Andy bringing a group of members together. And as Andy said, we were working there with officials to think about how do we do things better in Scotland. And I think that a lot of that engagement, the balance there, organisations like intermediaries and membership organisations, like, we bring a lot of members together to talk to, whether it's cabinet secretaries, the First Minister, officials. We can convene and facilitate those meetings to make sure the engagement. Now, in this case, we wrote out to all those grassroots organisations saying that day you came and spent with those officials wasn't wasted. But I don't want the burden of any register to fall on them. I'm probably happier that it falls on us. So we need to think about how we manage those type of situations within it. I think in general, we think what's proposed at the moment does strike a balance. I think, you know, there's other points here that we have to get to grips with in terms of some of the communications issue and actually who falls under the scope of it. And as we've always said, and many of our members said, you know, you have to readdress the issue of MSPs' diaries. Now, whether you call it MSPs' public engagements, you know, because actually if transparency is there, it's got to go both ways. And I think we want to see more transparency from the, you know, those being lobbied as well. And I'm probably repeating this all the time, but I think you need to seriously think about that as part of the bill as well, and that needs to be strengthened.
I'm going to, because Willie clearly wanted to come back on something you said there. I think it's proper to bring him in, because of course he is an objective observer of what goes on.
I just wanted to speak about the UK Lobbying Act, because, you know, people can decide themselves whether the government deliberately linked things together to cause confusion and fear. But, you know, the thing that the third sector, you know, is genuinely concerned about within that Lobbying Act was the third party campaigning in general elections or any elections. And Steve might want to say a bit of this. And that, and, you know, some people have suggested that that was deliberately put in with the bit about, you know, controlling a register of lobbying to cause that kind of confusion and to get it through. So I think there needs to be clarity on that. What is the third sector concerned about there? Is it concerned about the controls with third party campaigner, or are they concerned about the, you know, there's no sort of duty at all or responsibility within that lobbying act, the lobbying part of that act? I think, I don't know what you think, Steve, on that.
So there was certainly a lot of confusion when talking to campaigners to actually get them to differentiate in their minds between lobbying, which is, you know, trying to influence public officials and politicians, and trying to influence the electorate. And they're two fundamentally different things, two different audiences, and trying to get people to understand that was extremely difficult, because the government put them together within the bill. I think also the pace at which the legislation was rushed through Parliament as well was very unfortunate, which led to a large amount of confusion, and trying to engage campaigners in the run-up to the it actually hitting the House was extremely challenging, to get campaigners who hadn't really dealt with the non-party campaigner aspect, the electioneering aspect of it at all, and probably being the first time they'd heard about it. It was very challenging. I mean, luckily here, this is the third time I think there's been pre-legislative scrutiny of this part of legislation, which is extremely novel, considering there was almost none for certain aspects of the Westminster lobbying bill. So I think there's been enough time to sort of discuss and debate and try and understand that difference. But yeah, that, I certainly think that the confusion caused by the government was potentially, it appeared to be intentional almost with the Westminster.
At the risk of stating the obvious, it's obviously of value for us to know what's going on in relation to the Lobbying Bill, the Lobbying Act, as it now is down south. But I suspect you should not look to this committee's activities to remedy the perceived defects in that act, because you may be disappointed if you do. Andy, is it a narrow point, very specific to this? Because I do want to bring in others who have not yet spoken.
But very, very, very narrow. It's on the Westminster Bill.
Yep.
I would say that there is, in my mind, a clear distinction between the fears at Westminster about non-party political campaigners intervening in elections and the day-to-day lobbying that I'm doing all the time and should be registered for if there's a register, and quite happy to register for it, Neil. The fact of the matter is that a lot of that bill was driven by some fear that American habits of non-party political organisations coming in and campaigning against candidates at elections would be abroad. And I'm fairly sure from your discussions already that you're not going to be allowing yourself to be distracted by that chimera, or however you pronounce it.
Chimera.
I hope we're not going to be distracted into that one. There are lessons to learn from that bill because it does impact on the civic sector, but it's not that non-party campaigning business that's about.
Yeah, the business of PACs and super PACs looks fascinating, but I can afford to not spend too much time in it. Right, let me return to the list of people who've bid there. Richard. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Convener.
My diagram's upside down from my point of view, sir. On you go.
Thanks. So the CBI, first of all, is an employer's representative organisation speaking for businesses, and including sectoral trade associations across the UK and of course, in Scotland as well, where our members cover about 500,000 kind of employees. It's about a quarter of the private sector workforce. Our starting point on this issue is, as I'm sure it is the same for most of you, lobbying is an essential part of the political process. It contributes to kind of better public policy outcomes, and we also think that it should be conducted in an open and transparent way. And we think transparency is a good thing, but I think one of the key issues is that transparency itself is not a settled term, and I think it probably means different things to different people in this room. So we've got to find a sort of a shared framework for kind of looking at any new regulation that might be brought forward on this subject, and really reapproaching this from a regulatory affairs kind of standpoint. We're looking at it from our members' perspective in terms of the costs and the burdens that it might impose. We're looking at it from a practical sense in terms of how it might work and what might be realistic and proportionate. And in that regard, we think that the bill as drafted does seem to strike a decent balance in terms of looking at that proportionality. We actually kind of looked at the bill and looked at the proposals kind of over the summer and kind of before that, and from that regulatory affairs standpoint, by the Scottish Government's own kind of principles of better regulation, we're not sure it quite meets them. I think there's a lack of evidence of a problem. I appreciate that the proposals came as a preventative measure, but I think we also have to appreciate that the proposals do impose costs, and that's costs in terms of time dealing with the register, which may seem incidental. But the cumulative impact, I think, when you look across all those that will be affected, will be large. And it also presents an opportunity cost. What are the things that organisations will not now do that because they need to kind of focus attention on dealing with these proposals? And I think that anything that includes criminal sanctions, which this does as currently drafted, clearly there's a legal dimension there, and there are legal fees and legal costs that organisations need to bear. So while I think that the costs will differ depending on the types of organisation that might be affected, I don't think that we can kind of put aside that issue at all. In terms of the bill itself, I think the government's been seeking to find the right balance. I think there are some things in there that we would welcome in terms of the proposals from the summer. We welcome the focus on organisations rather than individuals. I think that makes more sense. We welcome the focus on face-to-face contact because I think that you need to look at what a proportionate system is, and I think that this is an effective starting point. And we welcome the fact that financial information isn't included. I think that opens up a whole other kind of tranche of considerations for organisations and businesses about which would add to the regulatory burden. I think there are some practical questions which I'll just kind of throw into the mix in terms of face-to-face contact. How are we going to deal with maybe the incidental kind of contacts that individual members of staff might have with politicians? I mean, imagine a site visit that you as MSPs might do quite regularly to people in your constituency. Take a supermarket, for example, a conversation with a member of staff on the shop floor. I am sure that it is not the intention of this legislation to capture that kind of interaction, but how do we do that? I think there is also kind of issues of sensitive commercial information that might be discussed at meetings, either with ministers or MSPs, and we have to ensure that any information recorded is at the right level. And then that point around criminal sanctions, to come back to that, I appreciate that there's a phased kind of process set out
in the explanatory notes in terms of dealing with kind of minor infractions versus the more kind of serious deliberate infractions. I think that has to be set out very, very clearly. I think that we don't want to get to any kind of situation where there are criminal sanctions implied for getting a form wrong or anything like that. And I think it's very important that as the bill goes through that we've got kind of clarity on that. So does it strike the right balance? I think that in the circumstances we'd say probably yes, but we've kind of questioned consistently the evidence base for kind of bringing forward the legislation throughout this process.
Thank you for that. I recognise Steve wants to come back and something you say. I personally, however, want to just tease you slightly before doing that. The CBI, like quite several hundred organisations that are registered under the Companies Act, actually operate under Royal Charter rather than Articles of Association as a company would otherwise be. Where is the CBI's Royal Charter published? Because I can't find it.
I believe the Royal Charter is available on our website.
Well, and neither myself nor Spice, who the parliamentary researchers, could find it.
So I'll be very happy to write to you.
It's just a gentle tease. But it does illustrate a more general point, actually, that there appears to be no statutory requirement for companies that are registered and have an RC code in the register of companies to provide that. There appears to be no statutory requirement at all, and I'm pretty confident many of them, by neglect, perhaps by design, simply don't have it there. I'd be very happy to receive that outside the scope of the meeting. Right. Anyway, Steve, I think, had a specific point he wanted to come back on.
Yes, it was just to do with the sanctions, as was highlighted, that at the moment there is only really criminal sanctions available for instances of non-compliance. Now, again, going back to my former stamping ground, the Electoral Commission had a whole range of different sanctions that were available to them. And they were obviously a thing of last resort. Everything should be front-loaded, as we used to call it, on advice and guidance to make sure that people had the knowledge and skills to be able to comply with the rules. And then it was about having ongoing discussions with campaigners to make sure that they were able to comply. When they didn't, whether because of consistent, dare I say, incompetence sometimes, or through willful negligence or willful evasion, there was a whole range of civil sanctions that the Commission had available to them. So a range of fines that could be increased or decreased depending on what the type of non-compliance was. I think there's a real danger that if you only have criminal sanctions, that if there can be persistent non-compliance with, let's say, for example, reporting requirements that may not be in the public interest to pursue via criminal prosecution, but then there's no other means of redress or deterrent for future non-compliance. And that results in what you call an enforcement gap, where there is non-compliance, but there's no means of actually getting people to actually start complying. Now,
you're opening up. I think this is something we do need to discuss, and it's one of our headings, but I think in the context of my trying to get through everybody, you're opening up a new topic, which, if I may, I'll come back to that a little bit later, and I've made a note to do so, because I really do want to hear from both William and Raj before perhaps, and it's William first.
Okay, thank you, Convener. I think just as broad observation in terms of the contribution so far is that there's actually quite a lot of consistency, consensus about some of the flaws in the bill as it's currently drafted. I mean, I completely echo the concerns that senior civil servants and special advisers are excluded as the draft has suggested, and it just doesn't seem to make any sense. It seems to fly in the face of the evidence that this committee has taken through the process, where people were quite open about their lobbying strategies and tactics and said that, of course, it's not all focused at MSPs, and this is no shock to you, but it's very surprising that the bill just seems to kind of want to focus on MSPs and ministers. I think also the exclusion of electronic communication and email just doesn't seem to make sense. It's frankly ludicrous. And it's one of the easiest things that people would actually have access to. So I think there's very little compliance burden. We're having to kind of disclose the fact of an email contact, not necessarily the content. And I think this is one of the things that kind of puzzles me about it. I've got two observations broadly about the bill. One is it almost stands in isolation from freedom of information and other transparency measures. I mean, this to implement this bill is going to cost a lot of money. And there's almost an inefficiency in not thinking about something like if a contact is disclosed, let's imagine a journalist will then start trawling FOIs, right? If actually we know there's already communication, they don't have to waste civil servants' time with going through a whole list of FOIs before they get to yet another round of FOIs to force this information into the public domain. Now, I think it's much easier if actually the fact of the communication is already in a register, and then people can make a more informed judgment about whether that's worth pursuing or if more transparency is needed in that particular area. The other thing I suppose I would say just broadly as an observation on this is, for me, just reading the bill, there's a bit of a tension here between the fact that the trigger for registration is about whether people are paid to lobby. And the rest of the bill is completely silent about that question of payment and the magnitude of payment. And I think we probably do differ from the CBI a little bit on this. I think in lots of the other more kind of the more mature transparency disclosure systems, that there's been a recognition that you can't kind of fudge this issue of payment, that in some way most of them have some kind of financial disclosure. Now, that seems to have been off the table for quite a long time in our discussions, but I think, you know, the bill almost recognises there's a tension there. That the metric that probably very meaningful for the public looking in on the whole influence game in politics is how much of resources are devoted to influencing decision-making, and you get no sense of that with the current proposals. So I just, as a kind of a pushback on this, because I mean, I think the public, you know, may be slightly dismayed by this. I mean, how much extra transparency will this bring to the process for the public who are not following the detail of activity at Holyrood? So I'm a little bit concerned about that. And just to go back to the very, very final point, which is about whether this kind of regulation will put people off interacting with the political system. I mean, that claim is made repeatedly in the kind of hearings we've had, the evidence and submissions, and I can understand the concern that's behind it, but just going back to some of the research that I did a long, long time ago, actually the first time this issue was debated in Holyrood in 2001, we contacted people who ran registers in North America, and they said quite the reverse. You know, the fact that you have registers begins to explain the system to people a bit more, and they understand how they can interact. So I think it's very possible to create a more ambitious register that, with proper guidance, can actually inform people about where the responsibilities lie. And I mean, the example in Ireland at the moment is quite striking. They have a much more, Raj can tell you more about this, obviously, but it's a much more comprehensive register. But the guidance is actually incredibly simple. I was just looking at it recently, and actually it's very easy for a member of the public or someone who might be involved in a charity who doesn't campaign an awful lot to see where they would have to register and what they would have to disclose. So.
I'll tell you what, I've got one person left who hasn't yet spoken. So, and we're now just on the brink of it getting more interactive, but I do want to hear perhaps from Raj, although this will worry John considerably because, of course, he's an educationalist. But he's from Dublin.
I'm from Dublin. That's fine. Raj. Okay, thank you. Okay, so these have been very good comments. I don't want to go over the comments that have been made already, but maybe what is good to do is to put them in international comparative context. So our research group works on lobbying laws and examines lobbying laws in different countries throughout the world. I myself am Canadian, but as William said correctly, was involved with the Irish legislation as well, and I'm very proud to say that I think it's actually very comprehensive. Look, there's some good things about the bill as I see it right now. I think it's very easy to criticize it, but it's also important, I think, to say what's good about it. I think the fact that it explicitly says that individuals who are lobbying and not being paid don't have to register and is explicit about this in the bill is a very good thing. This happens, and this was a consequence of why the UK for years didn't have a lobbying law given the Nolan Committee report. So I'm glad that that's addressed very explicitly. Compared to the UK legislation, as everyone knows, this includes in-house lobbyists as well, which is, I think...
Before you go on, do forgive me. You said it's a good thing that people who are not paid are excluded. Would you like to explain that?
Okay,
why I can explain it, but I would like to hear you.
Okay, what I really meant to say with that is if individual constituents want to talk to their MSP, they don't have to register. Sorry, if I wasn't clear on that, that's the only thing I was trying to say. that it's available online for free for public consumption. This goes to William's point as well, as I think part of the whole reason for having this to foster transparency and accountability, though I wish the word online and free were actually explicitly in the bill. It's in the explanatory memorandum, but it's not in the bill. Okay, so when it comes to the orally and in-person communication on what is captured as regulated lobbying, I have to admit, when I saw this in the bill, I don't think I've ever seen this before in any other bill that we've looked at. Generally, that it doesn't include telephone calls, for example, and more importantly, that it doesn't include written communications, is something that we found, that I found looking at this, quite striking. I've never seen this sort of wording before, and it kind of pains me to say that even the UK recognizes that lobbying takes place by way of written communication. And of course, civil servants aren't included as well. So a model there going forward might be to look at what Ireland's done and what Canada's done in the term designated public office holder, which would include things that Andy was saying as well, as advisors as well as high-level senior civil servants. So going forward, that might be something to consider. Going beyond a little bit of the conversation when registering, I found it a little inconsistent with this committee's recommendations and recommendation 9H in February of 2015 that a lobbyist simply has to state the purpose of the lobbying. This is very vague, and it doesn't go to the spirit of giving details of what's being lobbied on and who is being lobbied and what exactly is the intended outcome of the lobbyist. And so I went to the Irish legislation here. And when registering, the lobbyist there does have to include the subject matter, the name of the bill to be influenced, in particular if there is a bill, as well as the results intended to secure. Final point we haven't touched on here, and this is found, I think, in a lot of different countries' legislation, that refers to cooling off or revolving door provisions. These are remarkably absent, I think, from this bill at this point, at least in my point of view, given the number of countries that have these types of provisions, which basically refer to the idea that a public actor has to cool off or can't go straight into the world of lobbying without a delay in order to create a level playing field, in order to not use insider information when working as a lobbyist right away once leaving government. I know Richard had some issues on financial disclosures and thankful that it wasn't included in the bill. I think the other perspective would be that, well, why isn't it? The European Union, the Joint Transparency Register, actually does have some form of financial disclosures, and it's not considered, well, for in-house corporates it does, it's not considered a particularly robust piece of legislation in terms of having transparency and accountability. And it was just unclear why that was absent. I'm not saying that it's going to necessarily be easy for lobbyists to spend the time to do it. But again, if the end objective is accountability and transparency in particular, I think it would be something that your citizens might want to see as well. The final thing, I guess, is on exemptions. The exemption that if a minister calls a lobbyist in, it doesn't have to, the lobbyist doesn't have to register. That's what I understand. So this is really going down the wrong path. I think the Canadian legislation is a good example here. So in its first iteration in the late 80s and 90s, the Canadian legislation actually had this. And it said if a minister calls you in, you don't need to register as a lobbyist. It was a very big loophole. And the Canadian government realized that it was a loophole. And as a result, it made amendments to the legislation later on. So my advice would be don't start with something you know is probably going to go bad and start with something that, learning from other jurisdictions, doesn't need to be amended.
Right. Now, I've got a number of names that I've put down here, but I'm going to, because I cut them off earlier, go back to Richard, who I think had a very specific early point he wanted to bring up. Then I've got Peter, Andy, and John. Now, that may not be the complete picture, but anyway, Richard, if I may.
Thanks, Convener. I just wanted to come back kind of very quickly on the point around financial disclosure, because I think that there are almost two questions here. There's one in terms of what's your desired outcome, but then there's also the one around practicality, and these things aren't simple. And I think once you scratch the surface of an issue like financial disclosure, it actually throws up kind of a number of other questions. I think that there's a practical kind of issue around what gets included in terms of the financial information. I think when it comes to needing to factor in overheads, salaries, then it becomes much more complex and maybe is a much more complex picture than is being painted. And that adds, again, to the burden of needing to comply. I think there's a question around commercial sensitivity of information, fees paid for consultancy services and the like, fees paid or salaries paid to kind of members of staff. And I would also say there is a bit of a risk here that while on the face of it, financial information might seem a good thing, it's actually quite a blunt instrument. And I mean, what do we learn from it? It doesn't say anything about what the quality of the lobbying is, what the influence is, which is being achieved. I think that there are different kind of costs for potentially a large business to the ones that might be for a charity. So, you know, not all lobbying is kind of equal. In terms of the international comparisons, certainly the European Transparency Register in Washington and in the States, I think it's a stretch to say that these are perfect in terms of the financial disclosure. I think there are big assumptions made, and we perhaps shouldn't kind of hold them up as being kind of examples necessarily which we should follow. It's just that point on financial disclosure.
Okay, now, before I... Yeah, no, good. Sorry, I've spotted you. Right, well, no, come on in then, Neil.
Yeah, it's on the financial disclosure. When I did the consultation, we actually listened to those arguments, and what people are interested in is the scale of the lobbying operation. So they're more interested in whether you spend a fiver or 500,000. That's what they're interested in. And we were very sensitive to the fact that people were raising the issue about, you know, commercial sensitivity and all the rest of it. So that's why we introduced a banding to say it was between this and this. It didn't say exactly what the figure was. Understandable, you're bidding for contracts and all that kind of stuff, but it gave an idea of the scale, and I think that's the way to go over that. Given the financial information, I think is key, because it does tell you the extent of the lobbying.
Can I just quickly say something on that?
I want to just take a slight pause, because I recognise that my committee colleagues have been comparatively silent. Unusual for politicians, but there we are. And I just want to make sure I'm not missing their wanting to come in. Patricia does. And I beg your pardon. In that case, it was merely a passing expression over the face. Now, Willie, is it directly on this point? And Peter's getting really quite impatient, so I'm definitely coming to him next.
I just wanted to say quickly that on, you know, the PEPERA Act is a good example on how you can, you know, measure financial information on these sort of activities. And I've been a responsible person under that Act, and I know, and sometimes it is difficult in allocating bits of office space and staff time. But I think, you know, and if you ask the public what they would want to know about the level of activity, they would want to know how much was spent on it.
Does that tell you anything about the activity?
I think it does. It tells you, you know, how important it is to the people that are lobbying. It tells you, you know...
It's a measure of how important it is to the lobbyists, not... No. Anything about the lobbying. Sorry, I'm just being deliberately provocative, not trying to take a position.
But it does tell you, like, how much staff time has been spent on it, how much... so it tells you the power of that side of the argument.
Okay, Peter.
The power
finally.
That's massed behind it.
Oh, sorry, Peter,
Convener,
finally.
I would contend it tells you absolutely nothing of interest. The issue about financial disclosure really is that... And some of the elected representatives around the table will know this. Some of the most effective representations you receive are from people who are just the old lady up the garden lane, the individual at the bus stop who says, do you know what, I'm going to write to that committee convener in the Scottish Parliament and tell them exactly what I think. And because it has the authenticity and it's handwritten and you know they've put a lot of thought in, that's what gives it credibility. The fact that an organisation is willing to spend £100, £5,000, £23, whatever it is, tells you nothing about the effectiveness of it, I would say. I regret to say, from my industry perspective, a lot of money is spent on some very ineffective lobbying. That's just how it is. I would approach, and this goes back to, I think William's contribution actually was, he brought up the concept of paid lobbying, and then used that as to get into the argument on financial disclosure. Actually, I'd probably look at it, if I may, from the other perspective, and that is, there are people who are not paid to lobby, who are extremely effective lobbyists. Extremely effective lobbyists. A good friend of you, I suspect yours of mine, Gordon Aikman, is not paid to make the case for the case that he makes, but he has been hugely effective in the way that he's made it. And the money, as a result, he will make a difference, and decisions will be taken on the basis of what he said. So I think it's not as straightforward as just...
So he's very effective in his lobbying, yet he will not be captured in a lobbying register.
Absolutely, that's my point. My point is that I have to say, I think you need to look at the definition of paid lobbying, because paid lobbying excludes some very effective influence that is exerted by those who are volunteers, enthusiasts, but want to take a case across Scotland and make a difference. And very often they do, and they would not be captured by this bill. And the other thing I would just like which again came from William's contribution and also Raj's, if I may, is I think it's a useful hurdle to set yourselves and the Parliament over this legislation. We've all agreed that lobbying is a good thing. We've all agreed the Parliament needs to be accessible, and the way in which Holyrood has set itself up has been admirable in the way that its openness. I've been in another Parliament which has had a different culture and has not made as progressive steps in that area. But I have to say, if a useful hurdle to set is if this legislation were to bring in, brought in, results in conversations not happening that are perfectly legitimate in a way that they would have happened before, then this has failed. If it results, with respect to some of the submissions for extending the scope, if it results in emails not being sent that would otherwise have been sent, then I think this legislation will have failed. And that's my worry about extending mission creep, if you like. I've taken a view that, and I've conveyed earlier on, that I think this is proportionate. Become disproportionate, and this will result in Parliament receiving less communication from the outside world, and I think that would be a bad thing and counter to the principles with which Parliament was set up.
Emails and conversations are about.
On the basis of perfectly legitimate conversations, perfectly legitimate email, of course.
Anyway, just declaring that I'm the Honorary President of the Scottish Association of Public Transport, and my hero is Madge Elliott, who for 50 years championed the cause of Borders Rail. Mm-hmm. And has now been successful, and I suspect she's bought a few dozen postage stamps. And that's probably it. Andy, you happen to be next on my list. Then I'm coming to John and Steve, I think. Right, on you go, Andy.
Thank you. There are several points that I want to come back on. The first one is this question that Steve raised of equal access. My colleagues in England, Friends of the Earth, England, Wales and Northern Ireland, because Friends of the Earth Scotland are separate, put in freedom of information requests to find out how many meetings had been held prior to the new tax arrangements being set up for fracking companies. There were 19 with senior officials or ministers from the fracking companies to set up their own tax arrangements, and I think there was only one by a campaigning group on it. So this question of equal access does to a very large extent depend on resources in terms of what is a paid lobbyist. And I think the public are very, very interested to find out this kind of fact. And if the Register is going to do that, that's a good thing. I'm not sure at the present moment that it actually is. So just
to intervene, you're therefore saying to us that the test of success in this regard is that you could see there was 19 meetings from this interest on one side of the argument while there was one on the other side of the argument, rather than they spent £3 million to get the 19 meetings and they spent threepence halfpenny to get the one.
Yeah, that's completely correct, because in fact, as all of us around the table know, the one meeting may have been brilliant effectively and the 19 may have been a load of dunderheads who made no difference whatsoever, and you can't really come out and measure that. I've always been asked to give key performance indicators, saying, a bit difficult there. But I share the kind of fear that Peter is making here when you start using this term paid lobbyists. I'm paid, not very much, but I am paid, and I am a lobbyist, but the majority of my work is not lobbying. I only lobby part of the time. I try to darken the doors of Holyrood as little as possible. What I'm trying to do as an advocacy strategist is to get our members to come and talk to you, and to try and get the right members to come and talk to you, to get the people who have got expertise. Now, they may be paid by their individual organisations, or they may, like the formidable campaigners recently from the Scottish Allotments and Garden Society, who did a brilliant job and changed the law on allotments in Scotland in the Community Empowerment Bill. And they're a classic example of completely unpaid people. Now, they would have only registered voluntarily. And I read the policy memorandum again last night, and I can't really work out at the present moment what advice I would give to SAGs with regard to registration. I would probably advise them to register as voluntary in the spirit of openness, because, again, I stress that we are very much interested in open government and transparency. So I think they would probably be best being registered, but I don't know. And I come back to this question of paid lobbyists. You know, the warden of the Woodland Trust's Glen Finglas Reserve may well speak to several MSPs in a year. And it may be arranged meetings, and they will undoubtedly lobby, and they will lobby about some subjects which are financial. But it might take a few hours of that person's time. They're still a part-time paid lobbyist. So the registration process would be for the Woodland Trust, but my fear is that they would try and narrow down the people who were actually speaking to MSPs. Because this category of paid lobbyists, who was paid and who was a lobbyist. And I think it would be tremendously disadvantageous to the Parliament and to Scotland if it did lead to a professionalisation of the people from Civic Scotland who were in this building. As I say, I try and stay out of it. I try and get real people in here to talk to you about real issues with experience and with knowledge. And if I come along, it's just another political hack. And you can see that in the face of the people that sometimes you're speaking to. So I think it is important that as you shape the register, you make sure that there is something in relation to this trigger of the lobbyist being paid to reflect the fact that, as Richard has said, not all lobbying is equal. I mean, I'm constantly aware that the turnover of the entire environment movement in Scotland, Link and all its 36, 37 members, is probably less than the turnover of one large supermarket. And our ability to mount lobbying campaigns and spend millions or billions or whatever is tiny by comparison to the average corporate capacity to actually mount lobbying. Not all lobbying is equal, The real equality that counts, though, is the equality of the arguments that are brought before Parliament.
For good order, earlier I said an hour, but clearly we're not finished in an hour and we'll continue for about another 30 minutes. Now, that will require a little bit of discipline in expressing arguments and points of view quite concisely, if I may suggest to you. May I also suggest that we're, and in Andy's contribution, we've just particularly focused on what the access point should be for what ends up in the register and what not. And I think it would be helpful to the committee if those who are contributing are able to make some specific identified, what are the tests that are different from the tests we currently have in the Act. Now, I think we'd be quite content to hear later, you know, by writing or whatever, if that's the right way to do it. But I think it would be important to focus on that. And the other one, which I think if I recall correctly, Steve, I sort of shut down the debate about compliance. I want to, if we can, have a little bit of chat about how compliance works to test whether what's in the bill, because we as a committee, I think, informally think there is one difficulty in there. Right, so I've now got John, and then I seem to have Steve, I think, yeah.
Thanks, convener. I think we'll probably come back to you on some of the detail of some of these points. Let me make some general points. I mean, I think touching on the financial disclosure, or actually, I would probably think of that scale issue. I mean, certainly from SCVO's point of view, that for us naming X amount of people in terms of our public affairs activity would give you an idea of the scale, because we have public affairs officers, a policy, public affairs manager, myself as director, you know, and obviously our senior staff involved in that, you would get an idea of the scale, how we would allocate that in terms of all of their time. Funny, if I was looking at, we're about to hire two new public affairs officers, and I was trying to judge one of them how much time they'd be spending in terms of thinking about, you know, dealing with parliamentarians, and probably be less than 20% of his time, you know, and he would have to focus on parliamentary activity because he'd obviously be dealing with officials and other stuff. So we would rather see where we could be able to put the scale of our activity around that, and I think that would be more helpful for our members, particularly who have, you know, a staff say of 15, but you know, maybe only two or three people are dealing with policy work and maybe campaigning, if I use that in inverted commas. So it's not about, because that'll be their whole job. So you could look at the scale and that person, you could see the level of that person, you would understand there. I think in some of the other stuff, I think in terms of email communication, I think we'd need very precise scale again on and what you mean by that. I mean, we had John Swinney and Alec Neil in our office last night to meet a delegation of members to talk about the shape of the budget, and we had three emails about car parking spaces from officials. I mean, I don't say that to be, you know, take it lightly, but you're thinking there about what are the subjects that are actually covered in terms of that, and where does it stop? What I would maybe suggest is, particularly from a third sector organisation, that, you know, maybe the committee would want to bring in, you know, people like Shelter Scotland, Inclusion Scotland, British Heart, some of maybe Andy's members, small, and actually say, what does this mean to you in a practical sense in terms of how would you work it to get an idea of actually how it might work for them? And I know I'm going basically, take someone like Inclusion Scotland, 12 staff, brilliant organisation, do a lot of campaigning and policy work. What it would mean for them, I have no idea, but I think it would be helpful to get a better understanding if you actually spoke to those organisations who would have to implement this. I think that would be helpful for the committee. I think in terms of compliance, I think that is something that needs to be addressed, as Steve said. We've been thinking about it, particularly in relation to, we carried out a fundraising review over the summer, and it's very clear if you look at, say, OSCAR, which regulates charities in Scotland. And I'll give you an example. For example, OSCAR, there's 900 cross-border charities in Scotland. OSCAR lets the Charity Commission be the lead regulator, and they are the secondary, so there's a co-regulation situation. But if you look at it in terms of fundraising, OSCAR actually has very limited powers in terms of a regulator. Now, we could extend them. I'm not sure there's a need for that. But actually, so there are regulatory gaps in all areas, so we need to think very carefully about what that compliance would look like. And we can't go from zero to criminal acts, you know, criminal acts right away. We need to have a scale about what does it mean if you're not complying with the register. So again, and it's that proportionality, you know, in terms of how is the register kept up to date, for example, who's checking what people are saying, you know, are all going to be really important in this. And I think for us, I think the fact that it's going to be free is critical. You know, we had John Major this week talking about there should be a levy in charities in England to pay for the charity commission, you know, and that's going to happen with the fundraising down south as well. So, you know, we don't want to be seen a cost burden, particularly on organisations that we do want to register, but we want to engage. So it's that proportionality thing, but that's, we'll come back to you in some of the detail.
That'd be helpful. Right, let me take Raj, then Steve, then Willie.
Okay, just a quick question, or maybe it was an observation in the whole debate on compliance and oversight. I think that this is something, when I was looking at it, so if I understand this correctly, the bill provides for the register to be kept and maintained by the Clerk of Parliament, right? Further, the explanatory note talks about the registrar of the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body, which is a term actually not found in the bill itself, but the explanatory note talks about this, who will oversee and manage the administration of the register on behalf of the clerk. So that's one function. Okay.
That's the answer.
Right, okay. Then the second is that if you want independent investigations to be done, if there's a failure to provide accurate information, right, this is what a little you were getting at, this can be done by the Commissioner for Ethical Standards and Public Life in Scotland. Okay, so what you, it seems that you have, effectively on this oversight mechanism, you have two actors, largely speaking, involved. One is a registrar that reports to the clerk. And then if there's found to be some inaccuracies or if there's investigation to be done, this is done by a different office, which is the commissioner. Did I get this correct? So my question would be, well, why would you do that? Why would you split this into two different bodies? Okay, so generally when you have independent regulation done, say in Canada, for example, or even in the case of the commissioner we have now in Ireland, this is done by one person who monitors and then investigates and then would report to Parliament as well in the case of making yearly or six-month reports.
Without seeking to justify it, there is an explanation.
Okay.
And it's because it parallels what happens in the members' interest regime, where the clerks perform the administrative functions of recording and advising and encouraging those who have to provide information. But the skills of investigation,
right,
which are quasi-legal, are thought to lie elsewhere. And that is why there is that separate. Now, I don't use that to justify, merely to explain. And Peter, if it is... Now, I am beginning to run out of time, so needs to be...
It's a 20-second point, and that is, and the initial feedback from Orkel at Westminster is that actually there's quite a big administrative task to ensure that the quality of the information is correct. Mm-hmm. The initial feedback is from the registrar there is that actually the first-round registration quality is awful. One little point, and that is, I think the bill should look at trying to get the registration dates into sync. I personally think this random six-monthly thing, with different return dates, let's get one date, and I think it should be synchronous with the Westminster registration regime as well. Let's just try and create as few deadlines as possible so it's all immediately apparent.
I seem to see that having been written down.
Specifically, because what I want to talk about, I totally agree with this kind of random six-month thing. When am I reporting on this, that, and the other? I think a census date would be helpful, but this is every 6 months. The Irish system is every 4 months, and other places are even more briefly. The Canadian system for communication requires every month. So,
if you've made contact, then every month.
Yeah. So you register that, but actually, what you're doing is you're keeping, I suppose, in your mind, you're complying with this regulation. Now, that people might think that's more burdensome than once a year, but if you think about some of the tasks you have to do just once a year, and I'm on the transparency register in Brussels, and I come around to that and think, what have I done in Brussels this year? How do I comply with that? I've got to go digging through diaries and back records, which is a bit, to me, actually takes much more time. I think if I was to update it monthly, like the task I have to do monthly, it's much more familiar to you. And I think it might actually be easier to comply with it if it was more often and designed well. But I completely agree with the point about having a census date or something like that. Rather than it being individuals making a judgment when this contact happened and then reporting on that, that actually everyone knows that there are census dates coming up. And that, I think, will increase awareness in the public affairs community as well that actually this needs to be done. Right, I made my point.
OK, Steve and then Willie. And briefly.
And I'd support any sort of harmonisation of reporting requirements, especially with the UK register, just for those who are working across borders, then it simplifies it for them and arguably reduces the potential for confusion. Again, I'd also support Rajan questioning why there's two different bodies doing two different functions for essentially what's one purpose. From working in a full regulator, seeing how having within one organisation the compliance staff, the advice and guidance staff, and the enforcement staff in one body really does help to ensure that there's coordination and there's an understanding of how those different pieces fit together. I'm not saying that the arrangement that you currently have in place for members' interest doesn't work. However, from my experience, having it within one organisation is critical. And also, it's more of a question than anything. I did wonder why the Commissioner for Ethical Standards had an investigatory role when actually the sanctions available at the moment are criminal, and whether the investigations that would be undertaken by the Commissioner could potentially have an impact on any subsequent criminal prosecution. It's something that we always took into account as a civil regulator, and there was a large amount of coordination between the Commission, the Electoral Commission, and would be the Procurator Fiscal during the referendum or the Crown Prosecution Service about who had responsibility for it, because we didn't want to trample over the CPS's or the Procurator Fiscal's investigation. So it's more a question of how those things link together, which again supports the need for maybe introducing some sort of civil element there.
Okay, Willie. And we're almost on the last 15 minutes.
Okay. On the who's captured, I mean, I think in the last, and all the evidence that we've given in the last bill, some sort of threshold seemed to be reasonable. And while, you know, there's problems with that, people who are influencing policy might not get captured in quite a heavy way, you know, but the trade-off is that, you know, you allow easier, you know, more access and flow of information into the Parliament by setting some sort of threshold, whether it's like a half post or a financial limit on whether you're captured or not. So I think that's important. I'll just quickly return to the question of money, because would we then go back and say under the Political Parties Act that political parties shouldn't publish how much they spend on their campaigns because they might spend it badly and not have enough influence? I think the question is, does the public want to know this? And I think the answer is probably yes. And it's about public confidence. A lot of this is about public confidence in what's going on. So that's the points I wanted to make.
John, were you trying to catch my eye?
Well, yeah, I think we're talking a lot about public confidence and public trust. And I think, yeah, maybe quite interesting whether the committee wants to do some work on that, because actually, you know, it's bandied about, and I mean, certainly we're doing an Ipsos Mori poll at the moment about public trust in charities, given all the stuff that's happening in fundraising. You wouldn't actually assume that we'd be looking at that. And actually, I mean, are the public really interested in this? Some might be, some might not, but I've not seen a lot of evidence that they are. I certainly believe we need to make the whole system much more transparent, but again, you know, we can bandy about the public wants to know this, and I noticed the Information Commissioner was using it the other week for 80% of the public, you know, were supportive of our extension of FOI into housing associations. And I kind of thought to myself, really? I mean, depends what question you pose to the public. So I think we need to be clear on here why we're back to this, what are the core principles of this, what we're trying to achieve, and actually why we're doing it. And I think that would be helpful, because it's not in the bill as it presently stands, and I think that's extremely helpful for people in understanding why they're doing that, particularly small and medium-sized organisations who, as Andy said, would want to voluntary, you know, sign up, because actually they're engaging with parliamentarians and they're engaging with officials in different ways. And I think the point, coming back to, you know, the Gordon McNagman point about, you know, unpaid, you know, lobbyists in a sense, and a very successful campaign for Mind and raising a lot of money, but also the First Minister committing to more nurses for MMD and stuff like that. You know, that was because of that campaign that the organisation, you know, Gordon headed up, but he was totally unpaid. But, Mind did a great job, in that campaign. It was a fantastic campaign for the resources they had. Very small.
Right. Neil?
I want to ask if the public are interested in this. Well, I kind of hope that they're not, to an extent, because that's the whole purpose of bringing this in, that we don't end up with issues that the public have huge interest in that become headlines and we all end up there in the firing line. I think the public probably are interested in some of the issues in lobbying that's going on. I mean, I've just had a Freedom of Information request back that tells us that INEOS and the Scottish ministers met with each other 13 times before the moratorium was announced. I think the public would be really interested in that in relation to fracking. So
that was a failed lobbying attempt.
Well, I think
time I'm only will teasing, Mr. Finlay. Only I teasing.
I think time will probably tell that was an unwise statement.
No, it won't.
But anyway, no, it won't. That is an issue. That's an issue where I think there is huge lobbying going on at the moment that the public would be very interested in. But the bigger point is, I hope that they are not become fascinated with this stuff because there's nothing to report, and it's the preventative actions that we take that will prevent that from happening.
So, in essence, what we're saying in relation to the public is they will want to use it once in a lifetime. They will always want to know that they can.
Yeah. Raj. Yeah.
Okay, I think that's an important point, because if you have a mechanism for transparency where you can see who's trying to lobby who about what, the public can get engaged. But in our own research, we interestingly found that the biggest consumers of these registers are actually the other lobbyists themselves that are trying to see what their competitors are trying to do in terms of influencing others. So it's actually a very good professional tool for lobbyists to see what they need to do to try to influence government. The other is other organizations such as, say, a cancer society, Canadian Cancer Society officials, when we talked to them in Canada, basically said, we don't need to make these big reports every year now to tell our members or that are people that are giving money to us what we're doing. We say, go to the register, see who we've tried to influence on what with regard to health policy. And it became a very clever tool for marketing their own or for making known their own political activity. So it's not just the public. There are others that can get engaged and get useful information from these registers.
Andy.
I think it's a very important point that Raj is raising about who might make complaints under this legislation. And looking at international experience would be very valuable. But there's experience perhaps closer to home, which the committee might also want to look at. I suspect that if you looked at the number of complaints put to Oscar and their equivalent south of the border, you'd actually find that competing groups tend to complain against one another rather than members of the public. I know that the RSP... I was going to give you an example of the RSPB, who have been targeted by complaints to the Charities Commission about their fulfilling their charitable obligations, their charitable status obligations. In certain regards, the RSPB have been completely cleared on each occasion that the complaints have been made, but a great deal of effort and distraction has gone into clearing their name. The same has happened to the RSPCCA, who don't really operate in Scotland. It's the SSPCA here. But as I say, this is experience across the border with charities registration. And the other one, strangely enough, is from the Republic of Ireland, where everyone argued against equal rights of appeal in planning cases on the basis that everybody would willy-nilly be running to the courts. But actually, 90% of the court cases, I believe, are brought by other developers, not by members of the public. And it would be very interesting to hear from Raj and others about just who the complainants are in other people's registers.
Right. Steve, and I'm not sure if you caught my eye, John. No, it's all right, Steve.
Just to provide another example of where it's not necessarily the public who are looking at registers, as for those of you who have contested elections, you'll know that after you've contested, you have to submit a candidate spending return, in which lots of people end up spending a lot of time sort of looking at, your candidates, your opponents. And similarly at the national level as well, there's scrutiny there, and it's mainly I think that to a certain extent there are interested individuals and members of the public, but it's often political parties, their agents and party officials are the ones who look at it, and it keeps everyone honest. It's, you know, it's one of these ones that, oh, such and such reported such and such a leaflet, such and such reported such and such a donation. And if you can have a situation where you know, lobbyists as well are keeping each other honest, if you can say it that way, you know, as I said, I'm a lobbyist myself, and you know, we will be interested to see what other people are doing. I think that's that sort of self regulatory almost sort of mechanism there seems to have worked very effectively in the political sphere, and I think it can also work with lobbying as well.
Right. Now, I sense we're almost there. Now, looking around at my committee colleagues, are there any matters that any of you identify that we haven't touched on to the extent that we reasonably could at this meeting? Right. No. Cameron.
There was one question here that came up in the... who initiates the meetings? That was the other point I was going to raise, because I think that's quite important. Who initiates the meetings? Is it, you know, how easy would it be to show who initiated a meeting and what's the consequences?
I'm going to take John, because he did want to come in, and then come to you, Peter.
Just on that point, I think Peter made the point earlier about, you know, whoever initiates, you know, the meeting. Sometimes, I mean, we certainly get calls from MSPs and officials and ministers, and obviously we're calling them. So I think it just depends on what the issue is and what the workload, and certainly a lot of the stuff that we're getting is certainly that MSPs and ministers want to talk to some of our members about specific issues. And I think, so that should, as Peter said earlier, should be captured. But I was going to make the point, convener, if we're looking at this in the context of the whole thing, I think we've said in the evidence before that I think it's time to look at the MSP's code of conduct in relation to this, the ministerial code as well, because I don't think they've been reviewed for a while. And we know when we wrote a response to, you know, the Scottish Government's consultation, you know, ministerial diaries hadn't been updated since about, you know, June 2014. And I think that transparency stuff. And I think the bigger picture here is Scottish Government has now signed up very strongly for the Open Government agenda, which used to be driven by the UK. And seem to be putting resources into it, and seem to be much more transparent. They see this as one of the action points. So I think we need to see it in a wider context of how it actually affects more transparency across government in different ways. And I think the committee needs to maybe look at some of the other actions that are taking place there.
Peter?
I think John made the point. I mean, I don't think it matters who initiates the meeting, would be our view. The fact that, you know, I think the spirit of legislation would be that a meeting is taking place. To take Neil's example, that 13v1, I'm not sure if six of that 13 was initiated by government and therefore wasn't declared, if that was particularly unhelpful, I don't think it would be. I think whoever initiates it, it should be in a level. I think much of our drift is all about let's have a completely level playing field. Let's make sure that everyone, whether they're paid or not, whether it's discussions initiated by electoral representatives or not, whatever it is, let's make sure we are all treated identically. If we do that, I think we'll avoid many of the pitfalls of the Westminster legislation that, Camilla, you didn't want us to particularly stray in towards critiquing.
Right. Thank you all very much indeed. I, sitting in the chair, found that interesting. I think we covered a lot of ground. We did, of course, revisit matters which are probably beyond the process purpose that we have, which is to make a recommendation as to whether the bill that's before us, we should accept the general principles. That's the next stage. I suspect we're probably going to find ourselves able to do that, but we'll have that discussion. But of course, following that, there will be the stage two, when the bill will be subject to detailed amendment. And I think the report that we produce is an opportunity for us to indicate to ministers our early thinking on what some of the changes they should bring forward at stage two. And I think we've got some in our mind already. And if after today's meeting there are very specific points in that regard that anyone who's here or beyond here wants to make to us, then we'd be happy to hear that. But our duty is to now focus very precisely in the detail. We as a committee can make our own amendments. We don't require only it to be outside people, although that's an unusual process. But we certainly would do so if it appears they don't come from elsewhere and we think they're justified and required.
So, thank you very much indeed. I'll just briefly suspend the meeting so we can bring us to order for the next. I beg your pardon, we are now going into private session, so I...